Hello and welcome to this, the latest edition of Desert Island Movies. And today I am joined by actress, singer, the busiest person I've come across while doing this, Olivia D'Abo. Hello, how are you today?
I'm very good, Matt. How are you? Thanks for having me.
No, it's all right. It's wonderful to have you here. Now, as I mentioned, normally at this point, I would go through the person I have on and I would mention a few of their films and sort of they've been in this, they've been in that, and you'd all go, oh, yes, this is who it is. Olivia's been in 111 films, so we would probably be here for the entire duration of the recording of me just rattling off films. So I won't do that. We'll get to it later. People will recognise you from things like The Wonder Years, Conan, and various Star Wars and Star Trek, various other things. We will get to some of them. We're not going to get to all of them, but we will try. So rather than talking about that, let's get on to straight into your first film, Olivia. So do you want to tell us what your first film is that you'll be stranded on this wonderful island with?
My first film is going to be Harold and Maude. Be happy, Harold, you know, and I just love, she's almost like this spirit guide that's come into his life to turn him, sort him out and turn him around so that he can have, you know, an even more positive life than I think he would have had he not met her. So I just think it's a simple yet beautiful story. It defies ageism and it's really simple. They just laugh and they make each other happy and they connect like kindred spirits. And I really think they are soulmates. And I believe in that very much with couples that people meet. You know, it doesn't matter whether you're 18 or 80.
Something new each day. After all, we're given life to find it out. It doesn't last forever. Oh, it's all right. It's organic.
Harold?
Mort?
Did I tell you I'll be 80 on Saturday?
This is definitely a new experience for me.
To me, it really clarified that if two people meet, it doesn't matter what age they are. They really can fall in love. I mean, clearly, you know, Harold is, you know, this sort of painstakingly, you know, sort of negative, rather depressive angst youth. And he's driving around in a hearse, you know, one of those cars that you do when you're taking people to funerals. And he's obsessed with death and he's obsessed with faking his own death, driving his mother balmy. And, you know, I think sometimes with fate, we run into somebody who illuminates our life and invigorates our life to such an extent where we want to live. We don't want to obsess about the negativity of life. And we, you know, she's clearly three times his age, but has such an incredible, the spirit of a child, really. And she sings and she plays and she's the optimist. She's the complete antithesis of Harold. Maud is. And so these two sort of eccentric kind of two people meet each other, and it's just so rare that that happens. And I think that the story unfolds in such a beautiful way with this incredible soundtrack of Cat Stevens in the background and you know, complete songs that are actually played. God, the ending is so sad. He just doesn't want to let her go. And you know, obviously she's in the last chapter of her life. So, but even her enthusiastic smile on her face at the end of the movie, and she kind of blesses him and she says, go on and enjoy the rest of your life and be happy, Harold, you know? And I just love, she's almost like this spirit guide that's come into his life to turn him, you know, sort him out and turn him around so that he can have, you know, an even more positive life than I think he would have had he not met her. So I just think it's a simple yet beautiful story. It defies ageism and it's really simple. They just laugh and they make each other happy and they connect like kindred spirits. And I really think they are soulmates. And I believe in that very much with couples that people meet. You know, it doesn't matter whether you're 18 or 80, you know, when you meet somebody and you connect, you know it. It's like there's a familiarity. And also she doesn't judge him. I think everybody else around the Harold character, you know, sort of judges him and says, you know, you're too dark and you're obsessed with death, and why don't you meet a nice girl and just, you know, and why don't you go to college, you know, there's, but Maud meets and she's like, hey, you know, I think you're terrific, you know, and she just, you know, if you want to be free, I mean, that song is just so amazing, singing on the piano. She just, there's such a specific message in the film. So I can't say enough about it. And that's my first choice.
Wow. You've pretty much covered all the bases there. That was an amazing description. I get the feeling you may have seen it more than once.
I don't know. Shouldn't people who have a favorite movie see them maybe like it? I think that's what, that's the litmus test for a great film. It's like a great song. You can, you know, strip it down to a guitar or just on piano and it still holds its weight in gold. And I think a great, that's memorable, that you want to take to a desert island that you kind of couldn't live without, is something that's going to light your, change your mood, and you never get bored of it.
That's fine. Harold and Maud is one of those films I'm amazed they've not remade, because Hollywood does like to remake things. It's one of those ones that I've just always wondered why they never remade it. I suppose it's that good. I don't know. But there's very few things they leave alone these days. So it'd be interesting.
Yeah, it would be interesting. I some films, I mean, I'm sort of on the fence about that whole theme in general. I think that some films really should be left alone. And they haven't been. And, you know, but then again, you know, there's nothing wrong with a new generation being introduced to something really important that they can kind of take into their life. It's a really important piece of art, like a film like that. That actress who played Maud, I just don't, you know, we've just lost Betty White. And, you know, there's some incredible actors that we have, you know, obviously since passed, and it was a kind of golden age of cinema that came with it, the actors that came with it, actors, you know, Hal Ashby and people like that.
Yeah, and Bud Cort, who of course plays Harold, and Ruth Gordon.
I got to meet him one day, and he looked exactly the same, except he was a grown man. It was a little bit odd. He was like, I really liked you in that movie, Live Nude Girls. And I was like, oh, well, thank you. And I really, I am not worthy.
What was it like meeting him? I mean, did you talk about the film to him? Was it?
Yes, definitely. We talked a lot about the film, and he wanted to talk a lot about the film that I'd done, which I didn't think was half as interesting. But anyway, it was a bit of a banter just about acting and, you know, just how special that film was to me when I was an adolescent when I watched it. And it was just great. He's rather shy and not that far away from the character that he played. Not that he drives around
in a hearse.
In a hearse, you know, is obsessed with death. He rather enjoys life, but definitely an intellectual, and definitely has a very interesting take on life, and his philosophy is quite profound. So he was a cool guy. I was very, very happy to, very lucky to have met him.
Wow, that's amazing. That really is amazing. So what was the situation that you came to meet him in? Was it just happenstance, or was it an actual something, work or something?
No, it was actually I was going to see a music show with some mates of mine, and it was somewhere deep in the depths of Hollywood, and it was this sort of like green kind of purple lit club, actually, which is, I don't normally go to, but this was a long time ago, so I was intending to dance and listen to this this rave artist, and he was there, and I just thought, wow, what are you doing here?
A bit random.
Random. And But he was by the bar and I was getting a, you know, a drink, and, you know, there he was, and he actually approached me, which I thought was,
wow.
It was just like, it was like a cartoon figure with Bugs Bunny's like eyes go bling.
So there's the sequel, Harold and Rave.
What?
That'd be quite amazing. So there you go. There's your first choice, Harold and Maude. And I do recommend, if you've never seen this film, you should really check it out as soon as possible. That's a definite. So, yeah. So let's talk about some of your films. So recently, you were in a film called Lost Girls, which is how we kind of first connected. Was I was actually really taken aback by the film because it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a...
Hi, Angie, it's Mom and Dad. Where are you?
We believe your daughter has been trafficked and is being sold on an online site.
16, dark blonde, blue eyes.
You were a good girl last night after you stopped whining.
And, it's an incredibly powerful piece, and it has Jane Widdop, who's recently been seen in Yellow Jackets, which is everybody's raving about at the moment. So and she plays your daughter who is snatched.
Such a great actor.
Choose a project like that, because it you know, as I put in my review, it's not the easiest of kind of topics to kind of cover and, you know, make into, you know, a powerful, gritty film that's not just the message movie, but it's actually a really good, you know, absorbing drama. So how did you come across that? How did you approach it?
Yeah, so I a dear friend of mine, Julia Verdon, who put the piece together and is a real advocate of child sex trafficking, it's a huge passion of hers, who has this organization called Artists for Change. She approached me about this project and she said, you know, it's my first directorial debut. Actually, she had done another thing based on the same topic, but it wasn't a feature. But, you know, she had really big hopes for this film, and her impetus for her wanting to make this film was really to create awareness about this horrible thing that this is not just in third world countries anymore. This is outside our front door. And you know, being here in America, it was a real wake-up call. I think the film coming out when it did, which was sort of last year at the end of the year, it was almost like important whilst we were still going through the pandemic. And I think publicly we'd all received so much unfortunate news that I think at a different time maybe it wouldn't have had the same impact on people, because just timing is everything with films, especially if films with this nature. But she approached me and she just said, look, I'm putting together this really special group of actors, and you know, it's a work of love, and it's about a project that, you know, I'm passionate about, I happen to be passionate about as well. And so I said, yeah, I'd love to support you and, you know, work with you in your directorial debut. And I'd love to play, it was interesting to me to play a middle-class mother, American mother, who is very much a power woman, you know, her and her husband, she sort of runs a very tight ship, and is a workaholic, which is an interesting component in all of this and the theme of child sex trafficking, because, you know, the victims, the young girls, the young boys that are adolescents or even younger than that, a lot of times it happens to the kind of children or kids who are either coming from broken homes and the parents aren't attentive as they probably should be, because they have to work three jobs, or they're going through a divorce or whatever the situation may be. The point is the kids aren't getting the attention that had they had that attention, they wouldn't be, you know, taken into this sort of dark place. So I just thought it was interesting that the film was based in a middle class environment with middle class American, with an American middle class American couple who have these two daughters, and because they're so sort of busy trying to earn money and keep everything afloat and keep their children in the right schools and what have you, they completely miss the boat about the necessary caretaking. And not trying to vilify my character. She's actually, what struck me about her was that beneath all of the, you know, I have to make lots of money and I've got my husband in on this and we're working together as a team. You know, she's a very A-type personality woman and quite controlling. But through the experience of her daughter being taken in by these ringleaders is such a traumatic experience for her, for my character and my husband's character and my other little daughter who's left, that I completely... It turns her around, you know, where she adheres and admits and acquiesces to what maybe some of the things that she overlooked parentally. So when Jane Widdop, you know, who plays my daughter, gets brought back to us through these detectives who are sort of, you know, going into the depths of the darkness to try and find her, because she's lost, we don't know if she's dead for 2-3 weeks, which is a horrific situation for a parent to be in, you know, this unknown territory. By the time she does come back and we are in charge of rehabilitating her, you know, we hardly recognize our daughter. And Jane Widdop, who plays my daughter, hardly recognizes herself because, you know, there's so much shame affiliated with these victims, these girls and boys who've undergone a situation like that. They've almost had to give up their identity because they're told who to be, what to wear, how to act. That it's such a pinnacle point of adolescence where you're sort of trying to figure out who you are anyway at that age. So when somebody comes in and sort of tells you this is who you are, you have to kind of work backwards and backpedal and then start to regain your control of your identity. And so it's a very powerful film. It's a very hard film to sit through because it's not a bright and shiny film. It really, I think, depicts and portrays the way a situation like this would really occur. And it's kind of based off several true stories of victims of child sex trafficking. So, you know, we shot the film in maybe sort of 20 days. It was an extremely high-paced schedule. But I think because of that, it really raised the bar for all of the actors involved to give that all emotionally, which was a little bit draining at times, but ultimately fulfilling because it helped the product and the content of the film.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like I said, I was completely blown away by it. What I liked about it was, like you were talking about there, everybody's a victim in that film. You know, not just obviously the sex trafficking thing, which is horrendous, but also, like you say, the parents and the siblings and, you know, all the people connected to those people, you know, are affected all in different ways, but they're all affected quite deeply by it, because obviously, you know, someone going through that kind of traumatic experience and then trying to put things back together as they were before, but it's never going to be the same again. It's an incredible film, absolutely incredible film. Another film, again, you know, I always sit here and say you should watch this, but this is one of those films that I think, you know, people should watch just to, even if it's just to gain an understanding. I mean, I think people are aware that it goes on, but I don't think they realise, especially in the case of Lost Girls, how close to home, especially for the American audiences, that it actually is. And, you know, some of the statistics that are put forward in the film, it's horrifying, you know, these kind of things go on this close to home. It's quite a hard thing to take, but it is... Brilliant film.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm glad you liked it. I hope people are getting a chance to see it. I know that it was released there, I think, several months ago. Yeah. Different platforms. So, yeah, I mean, for those who are willing to jump in and sort of get a good dose of reality and be part of creating the awareness, you know, that's really the purpose of the film is to, and as an artist, you know, I love doing projects that are philanthropic, that can actually be eye-opening to people. You know, I love all the other work that I do, but I'm certainly at a stage now in my career, being that I've done a lot of work. What's really important to me now is the experience, and that I feel like in some way I can really help create awareness with topics that need to be more fleshed out and realized.
Absolutely. And on that lovely note, should we get your second film? And I'm kind of hoping it's something up tempo. No, I jest. It is a very important thing, but and like I say, I'm not knocking it at all. But let's move on to your second film, and let's see what you bring us next.
Yeah, Being There.
Oh, another excellent film. Yeah.
I love films from the 70s. I was not quite old enough to watch them until the 80s, but they were made in the 70s. And again, you know, Peter Sellers, for me, you know, he's my favorite leading man of all time, favorite actor of all time, him and Gene Wilder. And I love unconventional leading men who can make you laugh and cry at the same time. I think that's, for me, that's a bona fide movie star. I mean, Harrison Ford can do that as well. I love him. But anyway, back to Being There. That's number two.
I love Being There. I love, like you, I love Peter Sellers. He's one of those actors, like you say, one of those actors, he's just infinitely watchable. You can just, you know, one of his films comes on, you just stop what you're doing and sit there and watch. You know, I mean, most people remember him for things like The Pink Panther, obviously, as Inspector Clouseau, which were incredibly brilliant films. But Being There, I mean, yeah, Being There was just, yeah. In fact, thinking about it, I'm probably going to have to go and watch it when I'm finished recording this, because I haven't watched it in ages. And it is such a good film, such a good film. I mean, Peter Sellers, Shirley MacLaine, you know, it's just, it's a brilliant, beautiful film. What can you say?
And perfect film. I mean, whatever your criteria is for a perfect film, you know, I mean, I'm not picking huge blockbuster films. I'm picking more artistic, just perfect films that I think stand the test of time. I mean, my third is not from the 70s, but it's, I think it will have the same, it will leave the same trail of classic cinema that the other two do as well. And you know, Peter Sellers, though hilariously funny, there was a great melancholy to him. And I think that this film, out of all the ones that he did, really embarked upon that and allowed him to sort of bare his soul in a way that wasn't as animated and funny. And oh, I've got to be funny in this scene, like if, you know, if you were to compare it to The Party or something like that, or a movie where he's playing 7-8 different roles, where it just, you know, those are so much fun. But I mean, the simplicity of just from the beginning, the middle to the end, just such fluidity and perfect film, you know.
Yeah, I think because everybody's expecting a, you know, another Peter Sellers comedy, and it's not. It is, and it's not. But I think it was, I mean, because it was 1979-ish, I believe, around about that. It was like, I know that much, because I was very little then, as were you. We were both little at that point. But I had a fascination with films from when I was little. I mean, you know, I used to watch the trailers and stuff, and I used to watch Barry Norman on film, whatever year it was, even at, not quite when I was 5 years old, but as I got older. But I do remember Being There. I remember the poster, because it's him in the air, the thing. And it's just one of those images that stuck out for me. And then when I got a little bit older and I started discovering you know, the Pink Panther films. Then I wanted to watch more Peter Sellers. And eventually, you know, much like you, later in the 80s when I was a bit older, that's when I watched it. And I didn't really get it the first time, but the more I watch it, the, you know, the more incredible it becomes. It is his masterwork, probably.
Yeah, I love film.
Career of masterworks, it's probably his masterwork.
I think, and I think, you know, just cinematically, it was shot beautifully and shot in, you know, in New York and the East Coast. And it's also, I love how he affected all the other characters in the film, where initially they didn't understand him whatsoever. They thought he was a weirdo and, you know, trying to figure him out. And that scene with Shirley MacLaine where she's like stripping and trying to get him to sort of, you know, she's like, sorry, like, I mean, come on, you want some of this or what? You know? And he's just completely.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And of course, it also connects to Harold and Maude, doesn't it? Because of Hal Ashby, the director. So, yeah. Theme occurring there, I expect. Being there. Again, it's one of these films I'm just sitting here pondering. I should probably be voicing my thoughts, but I'm just sitting here pondering it because it's just, you know, it's such an amazing movie.
It, you know, it puts you in like Harold and Maude, which is why I choose the, you know, they do correlate, definitely. They just put you in a mood of disarming mood where you can sit back and really get the pace of how life should be. It's, you know, the film's not too long, it's not too short. Both films are edited brilliantly, but there's a disarming quality to the way it's shot, to the main characters, that the simplicity in the way they're living their life. And you know, and none of these characters are perfect, so to speak. And that really interests me as a viewer, watching characters that have imperfections rather than everything's hunky-dory, because that's just not the way life is. So, but yet it's done in a gentle, disarming way. And so you embrace them for, you know, them trying to find their way through, you know, this funny old life. And, you know, how they deal with obstacles, you know, which can be quite funny, you know, how we have to kind of wear lots of different hats in life to just get through the day. So they're both really charming and I'm just in love with them both.
Amazing. So before we get on to one of your other new films that you've got coming out, it's not actually out yet, it's coming out soon, it's called Bandit, and we'll get on to that in a minute. It's a film with you, with Mel Gibson and Osha Cuthbert and a few other people, but we'll get on to that in a minute. I do want to somehow try and cover your filmography, even though it's going to be... it's incredible. You know, I mean, I sat there spinning through your filmography, you know, and research before I start, just because I like to kind of go, well, let's talk about this. But I literally could be here for days. You know, I mean, let's start at the very beginning. Let's go back to Conan, your movie debut. Mm-hmm. You kind of drop yourself right into one of the biggest movie stars of the moment, in Mr. Arnold Schwarzenegger. You've also got Grace Jones in there, who she's a force of nature, that one. You've got Mako in it, who, again, another, you know, quality. I mean, the entire cast. How did you fall into Conan the Barbarian? I mean, Conan the Destroyer, sorry, not Barbarian, it was the first one.
I'll make a correction, actually. My first film debut was a film that came out after Conan. Not a film I'm as proud of as Conan, but it was a film called Bolero with John Derek and Bo Derek and a wonderful cast, you know, George Kennedy and what have you. So that was a Canon production. You know,
I was at a certain age, I was very aware of Bolero, but we'll kind of move on. Well, yeah. Let's talk about Conan.
Well, what I just, it segues into it. I got in to meet with Richard Fleischer, and Joanna Ray was the casting director, because of this hype about Valera. And that's how opportunities sometimes happen. Work begets work, and hadn't come out yet. It didn't come out till after Conan. But I was with an agency by then, and got in and read for Princess Jenna, and met Richard Fleischer, who is so lovely. And the last call back that I had, because it was between me and another girl, was meeting Rafaela De Laurentiis. So I went to Universal. I walked, God, I must have walked 2 miles to get to her office. I'm 14 years old. My mother walked, dropped me off, and then I sat in her office, and she comes in, she goes, Olivia, so I want to know what it is about you that you feel you can play a princess, because this girl, she's omnipotent, she's a psychic, and she's going to a journey movie, so I need to know. I know you're a good actress. I've seen the audition and everything, but about you, what about you that feels that this is your role? Because I really believe this is your role. And I said, well, Rafaela, when I was a little girl, we had a nanny called Marianique, and I was obsessed with princesses. And she was a French nanny when we lived in London, and she helped me draw princesses. And I just always wanted to be a princess. I drew them, I read about them, I went to Disneyland when I was, before we ended up moving to the States. And so I just really feel like it's in me. She goes, that's amazing. I can't believe that. What a beautiful story. I wish we could put that in the movie. Okay, you got the part.
Wow.
So there was a little bit of magic there. And of course they were packed my bags with my mum and my brother. And again, I was 14, and this was quite an adventure. We moved down to Mexico City. We did about a month of training with horses, finding the right horses. We couldn't find big enough for Wilt Chamberlain because he was so tall, 7'4". So they had to fly one in from Spain. And so we were practicing on horseback and rehearsals and this and that. And, it was just an incredible experience, working with Jack Cardiff, who shot, the River Nile with Catherine Hepburn and Humphrey Bogart. And those two had worked together before, Richard and Jack. And I was so bright-eyed and bushy-tailed about getting to meet Arnold, who had a very funny personality. And I first met him in the cafeteria, and he had these two, guys that he would work out with who were in the first Conan called Sven and Eric, and they were both as massively built as him. And it was like, they were like a trio, like an Albert and Costello, the Three Stooges trio. I mean, they really were very funny, and they were all, Austrian. And so the first day, I was sitting there, he was like, Olivia, I'm eating some rice pudding here, but it smells like it's a little bit off. Why don't you try it? And he literally put the whole thing in my face. I had rice pudding, just kind of dropping down. And, my mum was sitting next to me, and he and Sven and Eric were like, that's funny. That's really funny. She's going to be good. She's going to be able to put up with her personality on this one. She's not going to be a stuck-up actress. She's going to be funny. it was a load of jokes every day. It was, Grace was so fierce with her spear, and she put a couple of blokes in the hospital because I think, she hit him in the wrong place. It's a Catholic country. She did all her own stunts. I mean, we all did all our own stunts. Arnold kept us very fit, knocked on the door at 4 a.m. If you get up, it's time to work out. You bring your mom too. Okay, great.
Come on, I know you've had a really late night, but it's time to get you out of the gym now. Hey, Wilt, you too, just because you're a basketball player doesn't mean you get out. You get out for free. You need to work out, pump it up. You know, and we would all literally line up, come out of the hotel and walk with him to this plaza in Mexico City where there was a gym. He's like, I got these guys. I rented the whole place out for all of you, okay? We're gonna be doing this every morning. Everybody's gonna diet, eat a whole, you know, high fiber protein diet. And, you know, I mean, he was running the film. He might as well have directed the film. It was brilliant. And then he threw me my 15th birthday party, which is a birthday party on horseback, where my mum and I drove up to the mountains and we stopped at this sort of lovely enclave with trees and what have you. And we got out of the car and I see all these horses, you know, in this truck. And then Arnold drives up. He's like, Olivia, happy birthday. Here's some cowboy from, you know, Texas. So I was there for 6 months. We lived there. I was tutored there with a, you know, when we were in volcanoes, I'd get history lessons of, you know, what this volcano meant in Mexican history and how long, how many, you know, billions of years it had been there. And it was just an experience that I will take with me, you know, through my entire life. Just so blessed to have had that experience. And worked with all those amazing people that were doing Dune. He had to finish Conan because Dune was behind and had gone over budget. So, I mean, I was sharing a cafeteria with the likes of Kyle MacLachlan and Sean Young and Sean Penn and, you know, Timothy Hutton doing Falcon and the Snowman, and the Rolling Stones were down there doing Undercover of the Night. The police were there because Sting was in Dune. I mean, it was just madness. It was amazing.
That's not bad for a first year of movies.
We must have had a bag of chips. I mean, you
six
know.
6 months with Arnold, you must have been, like, you know, super ripped by the time you'd finished with him.
They were in some rather interesting outfits, I must say. They were rather... Yeah, the first month was full on with wardrobe, you know, costume, getting everybody costumed up, and everybody was Italian, so it was all terribly couture, yet we were trying to, the objective was trying to make everybody look like they were from, you know, ancient Sumeria. So I think they did a really good job, and obviously the monster was created by this Italian, you know, prosthetics man who created E.T., so there was a lot of talk about that by the time we got to the end of the film with the monster, that Daggeth, and I had to take his horn out of his head, and then he, you know, became this massive monster.
That Arnold puts pace to fairly quickly. Yeah.
Exactly.
So have you stayed in contact with Arnold on any of the others, or have you ever...
Occasionally at a place called the Rose Cafe, which is in Venice, California, where he is one of his favorite places to go, and he's got his big Hummer, you know, his like Terminator car. It's a big boy. So I'll run into him, and I run into him quite frequently, and Grace and you know, Tracy Walters, and that's about it as far as the cast member. I think Mako's passed on, unfortunately, and but yeah, definitely Arnold and Grace and Sarah Douglas, I run into as well.
Yeah, who was also in Superman 2, one of my favourite films. Yeah, cool. I'd love to have her on. Of course, she'd be good. Yeah, but anyway, yes. Wow, sorry, I'm going to sit here. I could listen to you all day talking about this. So moving on before we do run out of time. So you're also, everybody, like I said, of an age of me, as I said earlier, around my age, will remember the Wonder Years.
What would you do if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I will try not to sing out of key. Yeah. Oh, baby, how you lie? All I need is my body.
Another, you know, classic that's recently been remade. It's just been put on Disney Plus, a newer version. Have you seen it at all? Have you seen any of it? Or
I have. I worked with one of the actors on the new show, on a show called Psych, Dule. So Dule Hill. So he's wonderful, and Fred's directing, and Neil Marlins, who was the original creator, wife, Carol, they, you know, I guess Fred and because Fred and Neil are involved, it's very much got the bare bones of the show, and they definitely wanted that. So I think that was an important component. And yeah, great. I mean, it's definitely another interpretation that is very unique and very powerful, and there's a specific message in it. And I think it's important to cover this other part of what was going on in the country at that time, you know, when, not unlike the way America is a little bit divided right now. We're dealing with that with COVID and the vaccines and the non-vaccinated and the vaccinated, and obviously what political preferences you have, you know, it can create division. But at that point in time in the 60s, America, with, you had the pro-Vietnam people, the people who were not advocates, which was like my character, Karen, that I played. And so, but for an African-American family, you know, to you know, they're talking about civil rights, which is imperative to discuss for this new generation, and Selma and Martin Luther King, and they're getting into all of the things that I don't think we quite covered. So I think it's really a pivotal time for this embarking upon this new show, and I think it's being picked up again for a reason, because it's really speaking to people. So mm-hmm.
Sorry, you were saying?
I said I love it.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, I missed that. Sorry, I'm just sitting there listening to you. It's amazing. Now, what I'm going to do now, because
yeah.
I'm going to spin through a few of your films here, just for people to realise what you have done in your career so far. And I did put the element so far here. Right. So moving on from the 1D, just before that, you're in A Point of No Return, which was quite a big action film back in 93, which was Bridget Fonda. You were in that. Then we go to Wayne's World 2, again, another big film of the 90s. Then you've got some voiceover work. You do things like Pompoko, Asterix. You previously mentioned Live New Girls. Then what else we got down? I've got the list here because I'm not going to remember everything. I'm not that good. I pretend I am, but I'm not. Then you did the Mortal Kombat TV series, the cartoon series, where you were Sonya Blade, so effectively mm-hmm. the original Sonya Blade before they made those really terrible films in the late 90s. They were really bad. There's no glossing it over. They were awful. But hey, we all still kind of like them. Then, sorry, spinning through. Then you were Batman Beyond the movie. Again, now there's a lot of superhero movies in your in your spectrum here. So you are in Batman. You were also the original Black Widow in
the Marvel film.
Yeah. Batman Future. Da, 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 da. Oh, of course, yes, this was the other one I wanted to talk about. So you were Jane to Disney's Tarzan in the TV series Tarzan and Jane, or and the Legend of Tarzan. So how did you happen into that one?
The reason I got that, another actual live action film called The Big Green for Disney, where I played a sort of Mary Poppins English character who comes into a small town in Texas. And it's a movie about underdogs. It's actually a film quite popular with millennials because they were all sort of kids and soccer was becoming really big in the United States at that stage. So, you know, I spoke very much like this, you know, and I had a lot of enthusiasm and I was a wonderful soccer player and I was very determined to get these kids, you know, out of the depths of doom and being so down on themselves. And my main objective was to pick them up and make them feel good and get this small Texas town up off its feet with some sense of self-love and self-worth. So the animators who were doing Tarzan and Jane just thought that that character, if she were animated, would be a very similar character to Jane. Not that that sort of got me the job immediately. I had to go in and audition for it. And it was just one of these brilliant things where, you know, Jane was just an incredibly animated, high-paced, high-energy English, terribly, terribly sort of posh, but she wasn't, she could roll up her sleeves and get her feet dirty in the jungle. Do you know what I mean? And she was in love with Tarzan and her main objective, not dissimilar to Lucille Ball in I Love Lucy, was just to be with her husband 24/7, you know, and whatever it took to protect him, because, you know, not that he was I'm not saying that Tarzan wasn't as bright as Jane, but you know, he didn't really speak. You know, there's a bit of a, oh, are you love me, Jane? No, I'm sorry, that's the wrong impersonation. Like, Jane, love me? You know, that kind of thing. Like, yes, I love you, Tarzan, and we're gonna be all right. We'll just go on the chutes and ladders and we'll, you know, I'll talk to my father, the professor, who's, you know, another wonderful animation actor who I've worked with several times. But it was great. I would go to work in my pajamas every day and the animators would be there and they'd be sketching as I'd be sort of behind the mic. And after, you know, having about 4 or 5 cups of tea or coffee to get the caffeine up, so that, you know, I could just sort of be really, you know, it was very high paced. The only direction they ever gave me was like, could you just say that a little bit quicker? Because I mean, the character I sort of already had, you know, it spoke to me and it got under my skin and that was just it. So it's like, I morphed into her whenever I got behind that mic. But, you know, they'd say, oh, could you say that whole sort of monologue and just crunch it, you know, cohesively, just say it all much more fast paced and just get it in within, you know, within sort of 30 seconds. No problem, you know. But it was really an amazing experience, not unlike the experience playing Luminara in Star Wars, Clone Wars, not only the film, but the TV show, where having animators in there, they do really take upon your likeness and they sit there and they look at your behavioral mannerisms and your expressions, and they take that all and they implement it into the role while they're animating it. So their sketches are very important. So it's that real time thing that's not just like theatre, not unlike theatre.
Yeah, I was coming to Star Wars. Yeah, I mean, Star Wars, again, someone of my age, you know, Star Wars effectively changed my life. So, you know, having, you know, getting involved in Star Wars, Clone Wars, and then ended up in the last of the, well, for now, the last of the Star Wars movies, I suppose.
That was J.J. Abrams' idea, because he wanted to sort of cross-pollinate, you know, the Clone Wars, Star Wars, and the character Jedi's in there. I was very lucky because in Clone Wars, I was sort of killed off, and I don't think Luminara necessarily got best. I mean, you know, I'm fine with it, but I'm constantly, whenever I'm on social media, I'm constantly have to sort of field these rather angry remarks. Why didn't, you know, she's a Jedi, for Christ's sake. Why didn't she get a better ending? God, she was stuck in a cave, and what the hell? you know, I've heard the same thing about Nicole Wallace, you know, the nemesis that I played across from Vincent D'Onofrio in Law and Order Criminal Intent. It's like, how, you know, why did they kill her off like that? And, you know, they just sent her heart in a, you know, in a glass thing. And, you know, fans get very dismayed about that stuff. But luckily with Star Wars, J.J. Abrams had this great idea. And so he said, you know, let's bring eyes, whether they, you know, whether they're coming back from past lives or as ghosts or whatever. Let's put all the Jedi, you know, together to be the voice of reason for, you know, the main character. And I got to work with J.J. Abrams for like 3 hours and went down to the Los Angeles Star Wars Fort, which is in Santa Monica, and it was just epic. I mean, you walk in and you see walls, and it's like a museum of all of the characters and all of the actual rooms and you know, the prosthetics, and they've got a huge counter for with chefs cooking whatever your heart desires, if you should so wish to dine there. And I went up into this room, and I didn't actually know I was going to be working with J.J. Abrams. I just thought it would be sort of like a, you know, a session with another director. But no, he was full on. He wanted to be part of every single part of it. And he came in and he'd sort of whisper in my ear and he'd say it this way, you know, I really like what you're doing now. Now, just say it in your own words. And so he gave me the opportunity to do that. That was just a dream come true.
It's amazing. I mean, I've skipped quite a few here because there's a lot we could go through, you know, the Animatrix and, you know, Spin City, things like that. We could talk about these all day, but we would be here all day. When you look back at your career, it's not going to be one that you're going to regret, I don't think. You know, when you do finally decide to retire, because, wow, I mean, the length and breadth of what you've done and the people you've worked with, and, you know, it's incredible. And, you know, you're not halfway done yet. So who is there left to work with? Is there anybody left you haven't worked with, you really, really like to work with?
Well, Mel Gibson is definitely one of them. That's been an absolute... And Helen Mirren, I'd love to work with. Judi Dench, Jessica Lange, Daniel Day-Lewis, if he doesn't retire. Sean Penn. I mean, Gary Oldman. I worked with him actually once on a Jason Alexander spin-off after Jason finished Seinfeld, and he was lovely. But, you know, I've just worked with Danny Houston, who I love, in a film called Traveling Light with him and Stephen Dorff, about to come out. And, even people that I don't know yet, I'm the kind of person where there's people I don't know and then I meet them on movie sets and they're just so wildly talented, you know, like Jane Widdup, for example, who played my daughter in Lost Girls. She's just a remarkable actress. She's like a young Jodie Foster, and I hadn't ever seen anything she'd done. And for me, again, like I said, going back to what I said a little bit earlier, it's about the experience now. So it's about, I've worked with actors who have huge egos, because they're such huge movie stars. And then I've worked with other actors who are just as huge of movie stars, but they leave their baggage at the door. They leave their ego at the door and they're just there to do dangerous work in a safe place. And hopefully I'll continue to attract that kind of potpourri of just brilliant thespians, you know, and directors. Yeah. And, you know, I've been very, very blessed. And lucky, and you know, and the roles seem to keep getting better, which is, you know, I know that as actors get older, you know, people say, oh well, you know, it kind of starts to dry out at this, and I think that's a choice. I think it's sort of like where you are in your life and how you're. I think I've always believed, and it's always been the case with me, that if my life is full and I'm doing the work to evolve and to become a better person and a deeper person, then funnily enough, the roles come that match and align with. So yeah. Philosophy, because there's the acting and there's the talent that you need, and there's the authenticity of what you think you have to say that's different than anybody else that keeps you going. But then there's the side of the business that can be quite cutthroat, and some actors just they can't balance the two because they're so different from each other. So I think that's where either a strong spiritual practice comes in, or just knowing yourself so well that you slough it off, you don't half-ass it. You know, you have a self-tape or an audition or a meeting or a project, you put everything. I do anyway. I like to either morph characters or just put everything I have into that character. So at the end of the day, and I like, though I'm being directed, I like to sort of bring as much of myself into it and my own interpretation of how I see it. And usually that's why I get a role. And then I go with that. And then that sort of allows me to not half-ass it, because it keeps me enthusiastic and passionate about seeing it from beginning to end.
And this is quite clearly why you've been so busy throughout your career so far. just the absolute energy. I'm in awe, I've got to say. Anyway, I've got to get on to your third film, or else I'm just going to sit here and listen to you tell me anecdotes all leave. And it'll be, I should point out, we are recording this quite late at night because of time zone differences. And if we carry on, it'll be the morning by the time we finish. I might get in trouble. So come on then, tell me what your third film is that you're going to be stranded with.
Yeah, so my third film is Call Me By Your Name.
Call me by your name and I'll call you by mine.
Oh, interesting.
How'd you like that one, Ducky?
Yeah, come on. So talk to us about it, Mr. Chamolet and co.
Yeah, I just was really, I wasn't sure how I was going to feel about it. And actually my son told me, he's like, yeah, Mom, like, this movie's just so epic. I mean, like, it's... You know, just like, clearly, you know, like, I'm totally hetero, but like, I could see like, why, you know, why, like, I got it, you know, and it's just, I think, first of all, the most romantic setting of any film I've ever seen, right? I mean, they were in France, in the south of France, or was it Italy?
It's Italy.
Italy, okay. So in Italy, but speaking, you know, people speaking French, speaking Italian, Timothy's, parents in the film were just these kind of very, the father's a professor, and just the fact that he brings the other character on board to be his apprentice, you know, at the age, the ripe age that Timothy was at, where I think most adolescents are kind of just discovering who they are, you know, that, you know, they're discovering their sexuality. I mean, I just thought that it just, the love story between the two of them was, and I've seen, not to compare it to Brokeback Mountain, but I also love that film. But again, like, not unlike at Harold and Maude, in the way that defied ageism, I felt it reminded me of like the love story between Rumi and Shams, you know, the Turkish poet and Shams, and, you know, they fell in love with each other's soul, and the heartbreak that Timothy encountered in it was so moving to me. I also loved the soundtrack, though it's not my favorite soundtrack. We'll get to that in a bit, but I just loved it. It was poetic. It was well written. It was, I felt watching it that I was a fly on the wall, if you know what I mean. It was incredibly intimate. It's like you could hear people breathe. the house that they were in and the interior designing and the setting and the colors. And it was like seeing one of my favorite paintings, like a Dali or a, you know, Paul Klee painting or something like that. It spoke to me. I mean, I am European, and so I understand what it's like to have a summer in the south of France or the north of Italy or the south of Italy or Spain, you know, you know, at a very young age where you haven't yet fallen in love. And when you do, it's like no other love. It's young love. It's, I don't really know how else to describe it, but it's just so beautiful. And it cuts so deep. And it goes so deep. I mean, obviously, the heartbreak of the film cuts so deep. It was incredibly well acted. The chemistry between the two of them was just immaculate. And his relationship with his father that he talked about his love for the father's, you know, apprentice who he'd had this love affair with, and even in the other girl that he was seeing, and how, you know, he didn't mean to break her heart, you know, but it was almost like a Shakespearean, you know, those Shakespeare plays that he does where, you know, somebody's with the other person that the other person wants and doesn't quite end with.
Just mass tragedy. And it's the film that exploded Timothy Chalamet into the world.
I know.
I mean, which kind of circularizes back to June. You know, all those years ago, you watching June, and here we are talking about Mr. Chalamet, of course, is leading the new version.
And that's like first song, Love My Way, is just, it's set in the 80s, right? So that soundtrack and the music, it came in so perfectly. It, you know, this just underlying, almost, you know, mystical, sort of, you know, suspenseful, sexy, you know, song that was really their theme song, and romantic, so romantic. I mean, out of everything I've said, it was one of the most romantic moving films that I've seen in the last 20 years.
So is that the kind of films you're like? Are you a big romance fan, or are you like a, do you have a particular genre, or you, because Harold Maud's very romantic in a kind of strange way, but it's, you know, very romantic within itself. Being there's technically a kind of a love letter more than a love story, but so are you big into romance stuff, or is it you just like to be taken on that journey?
I am definitely a romantic, and I just love committed performances where people lose themselves and they don't give a toss how they, you know, I love actors that are just, you know, Timothy just blew my mind in that movie because he was like an androgynous soul that just, the way he moved and his body type, you know, he's just, he can just morph into anything. And I just felt he was so open. It was the most open-hearted. I love open-hearted movies where the actors are almost channeling it rather than just saying the lines, they're just in it. And so more than anything, though I am a romantic, I love films, and these three I think all have that, where there's you feel like you're walking side by side with these actors, you know, and they just break them. So I just look for authenticity.
That's what will keep you until you're rescued.
Hey?
That's what will keep you until you're rescued. It's the, you know, love will find a way.
Yes. Absolutely. But it must, love must always find a way. Love is king.
Yes, absolutely. Especially in this day and age. So.
Yeah, it's worth its value in gold even more so, you know, and when you feel it in this day and age, it's really like a breath of fresh air.
Absolutely. So let's talk about The Bandit, which is going to be coming out very soon, because I've had a press release drop in my inbox, so that means it's on the way.
And do what?
Rob it.
So this was one of the actors you wanted to work with, Mr. Mel Gibson himself. It's also got Elijah Cuthbert in it, Josh Duhamel, your good self, among other people. I mean, there's a great big long cast. I'm looking at the cast list here. Great big long cast list. So tell us about the film. Tell us who you are in it. Tell us what to expect.
Right. So the film is actually a true story about a man by the name of Gilbert Galvan, who was a bank robber in the 1980s. And the film was set... it's supposed to be set in Toronto, well, in Canada, just past the border in Ontario. It's basically this man, Gilbert Galvan, robbed about, you know, just hundreds of banks back in 1984. Around the time that they had that huge electrical problem where all the lights went out in Canada and they couldn't, you know, it was kind of a historical thing in Canadian history. But in any event, the main role playing Gilbert Galvan, is played by John Duhamel, who's brilliant in it. And just to give you, I don't want to give too much away about the film, but basically Josh plays, you know, he's from a very kind of corrupt family life. You know, he's got various brothers and sisters. The father was a criminal. The mother kind of gave the kids up because she couldn't, you know, she just couldn't afford them because the father had sort of split, so to speak. And so the film starts out where Josh is in jail and he gets out and he has his mate take him across the border so that he can sort of start his life again. He doesn't have any money and he stays in sort of a almost like a, it's like a squat, but it's a sort of a few stages up from, you know, one of those grotty squats. It's actually run by nuns. And he meets Alicia Colbert there and he just thinks she's the most amazing thing he's ever seen. He falls in love with her. They start a romance and subsequently she gets pregnant. He finds out about it. He has no money. He's got to figure out how he's going to keep the girl and the baby. And he's got to have a plan. And he walks into this shop and it's a sort of costume shop and there's a bank across the road. And he says, you know, he's very quick on his feet, very charming, thinks he's very smart, savvy guy, street smarts. And he says, you know, can I borrow this costume, you know, for, and I'm just going to be about 10 minutes. And he sort of flirts with the girl and he's like, I'll make it worth your while, you know. And so he puts on this clown suit or whatever it is, goes across the street, robs a bank, and he starts to get into this, you know, pattern of, you know, the rhythm of all these bank robberies. He's starting to make quite a bit of money, and, you know, his girlfriend is wondering how he's suddenly, you know, quite becoming richer and richer. Anyway, segueing into Mel Gibson's character and my character, who are a married couple who run aesthetically from the outside what seems to be a strip club. And Mel is an ex-boxer who's turned into a loan shark. And so he lends people money and we run this strip club. And I'm like a matriarchal bartender who sort of runs the show, keeps Mel in line. And I've seen everything, but I sort of always have his back. And then there's a wonderful role of a detective played by Nestor Cabanel, who's an actor who I just adore. He's on the morning show. I don't know if you've seen that show, but he's brilliant. He's the detective throughout the whole film who's trying to catch Josh Duhamel, and he does eventually catch him. Mel and I have a backup plan, and we get away scot-free, which is a good thing. And it's a suspenseful thriller. It's funny. It's got amazing actors in it. It's really well directed and it's really well written. And it's a fugitive film. I mean, you know, it reminded me very much of the Harrison Ford film, The Fugitive. However, it's not like that film. It's on a different level. I'm not saying it's better or worse. It's just, it's its own thing. And set in the 80s, so a lot of shoulder pads and, you know, George Michael MTV videos and cool stuff like that. So, yeah, it's probably going to have a great soundtrack, I imagine.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of fun. Well, everybody, I'm going to put all the details about this. I've also decided I'm going to put your IMDb link in there because people need to see what you've been in because there's just so much. So I'm going to put all that down here at the bottom and people can click on the links. So I'll put in about Bandit and I'll put in about Lost Girls, definitely. And that will all go in there. Now, before we get to winding this up, we need to talk about your soundtrack. So what music are you taking with you to the island?
Well, I'm going to take the Graduate soundtrack with me.
Know what I mean? Yeah. I'm not going to do the line.
it was a toss-up with several things, but I think there's something classic. I was just trying to think of something that when I just Scarborough Fair and as soon as that line, "Hello darkness, my old friend, come to visit you again." Anne Bancroft's performance, obviously, that's another film that I love, but in terms of just straight up soundtracks, it's just perfect. Mm-hmm. I mean, and that's one of my favorite film directors as well. So, but yeah, it's just classic and timeless and Simon and Garfunkel at their very best.
I was going to say, a little bit of Simon and Garfunkel while you're lounging on the beach, that'd be quite... quite chilling. Yeah. I like that. Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, Mrs. Robinson on the beach there. Yeah, that'd be very nice.
Like a bikini.
So there you have it. We have your three choices. So we have Harold and Maude. We have Being There, and we have Call Me By My Name, and then your soundtrack, The Graduate. So you're happy with that? You're going to be sitting on this island, we don't know how long for, so you're happy with all of those?
Yes, and I'm ready for a holiday to sit.
Absolutely, aren't we all?
I'm wandering with the sea behind you and the sand, and I don't think that's all right. I'll bring my own.
That's fine. Yeah, that's fine. So it's been absolutely fantastic having you on the island for this short amount of time. It's been absolutely brilliant. Like I said, I'm going to put all the links of everything down here, your social media, everything, so people can watch, see and find you and come and listen to you do some more impressions of Arnold Schwarzenegger, who I am definitely tagging into this because I want him to see this. I also want him on the show, but I want him to see this. So I think I may even cut out a little trailer with you doing Arnold impressions. I think that would be quite cool. And next time you see him at the cafe, who knows, he might tip another bowl of rice pudding over your head. But it's been absolutely fantastic. So thank you very much for coming onto the island, Olivia. And I can't wait to see Bandit. I've got a plethora of your films to go through anyway, because there's quite a few I haven't seen there. So thank you very much for coming on. And we will see everybody on the island next time with whoever our next guest is. So thank you for coming. Thank you for watching. And we will see you all soon.
See you all soon. Bye.